Hopefully you can hear me now. OBS issues, am I right? Goodness. It's good to have you here, everybody. And welcome back to Paleontologizing. Thank you for your patience while we resolved that right now. All zero viewers, as OBS currently says. I know that's not true. Thank you to those of you who stuck around there. Really appreciate you. Yeah, we've all been there, right, Tassie Jane? It happens. Yeah. Anyway, it's so good to see everybody today. Welcome back to Paleontologizer. Today we're going to have, kind of like yesterday, a more casual kind of stream. And I started a little bit later today because I'm going to be raiding into Science Streams and doing a collaborative stream with Belint from Science Streams. And I think we're even going to be on the front page, which is going to be really awesome. Blint currently has like 400 people watching, so he's on the front page again, which is fantastic for science outreach here on Twitch. Anyway, if it's your very first time here, then an extra special welcome to you. And let me introduce myself. My name is Danny Anduza. I'm a dinosaur paleontologist. You probably know already that a paleontologist is a fossil scientist. I work on dinosaur fossils in particular. Dinosaurs are my passion. It's the time I was a small child, and I've been very lucky in being able to basically pursue a career in dinosaur studies. So dinosaurs are what I study, what I publish on in the scientific literature, what I excavate in the field. Check out the YouTube page if you want to see some of the recordings of our live streams from the field this summer in Utah and Wyoming, digging up dinosaurs, at least 3 new species. We're digging those up live, and it was a ton of fun. Such a privilege to be able to do that kind of science outreach, you know? Anyway, that's what we're doing here too. If any of you have got any questions at all, not just about dinosaurs, but maybe about broader concepts in natural history, talking about the development of life on Earth, extinction and evolution and speciation and how our present world came to be. It's a remarkable story, and it's incredible that we can know anything at all about it. But we know so much, I think more than most people realize. So if you have any kinds of questions about the history of life on Earth, please do not hesitate to ask those questions. That's, you know, what these streams are all about, you know? Yeah. By the way, let me kind of readjust this. There we go. That's better. This one and this one. Excellent. Good, good, good. Anyway, so good to have all of you here. Yeah. New office is looking fantastic. Thank you, Narwhal. Welcome back to you, by the way. Good to see you. Yeah. And the paper discussions are a ton of fun. I'm glad you like those, Steely Dan. Yeah, they're a lot of fun for me, too. It's nice to be able to shoot the breeze with a fellow scientist and kind of see where our different fields overlap or where there might be differences. I miss that kind of discussion, you know? I used to have a lot more of that back when I worked at various museums or in the field. I get a lot of that. Yeah, I had that at university. Don't have too much of that on the day-to-day basis nowadays. So it's really, really nice to be able to talk with Belint about science. Yeah. And Stinky Winky says, hi, Danny. Nice to meet ya. Likewise. Stinky, it's good to have you here. Yeah. And, yeah, yeah. And new office, it's official. Yeah. And it, yeah, of course. And, we are very, very close to our goal, as Lenina is pointing out. 23 points away. Excellent. Yeah. Thank you everybody for helping us get there. I think we just might make it to our Partner Plus goal. Excellent stuff. Let me, we already lost the top of chat because I had to restart OBS. But, let's see who's here. Tommy Plotticus, Sammy Kien, Stinky Winky, Matt M33, Lenina, 5280 Andy. And look at this lovely bird sent to us from Vainglory. I don't know why it's not showing up in the activity feed. I haven't something's borked right now, but thank you for... Oh, shoot.
Vainglory TX is overloading the system with 10 gift subs.
Holy cow, Vainglory. I appreciate that more than you know. Thank you very, very much. Helping us get ever closer to our sub goal.
Try blaming the dinosaurs.
And thank you, Cyan Streams, for the 100 bits. Gesundheit. Let's try and let's get this dock up and running again. OBS is not cooperating right now. There we go. So to restart that bit. Thank you so much, Bullet, for those 100 bits. I appreciate it very much. Looking forward to our discussion today. Yeah. Who else we got? Golganek, Avalon Angels, Jody Fish, Harry Vetch, Mudman 1965, Smorphosaurus, Sothi St. Goingwell, Baja Smancer, Avalon Angels. Did I already say hello to you, Avalon? If I didn't, hello. If I did, hello again. Kodali, welcome, welcome. Filthy Badger. Filthy Badger, you might need to reload the page if it's not working for you. Gene Wen, how are you doing? Camera's having a lot of image noise. Uh-oh. Are you seeing a lot of... up here on this side right here? Can you see that too?
If it hadn't been for that great dinosaur who saved us from the American forces, we would all be dead.
Filthy Badger.
8 months of dinos.
Filthy Badger, I appreciate your ongoing support. Thanks for keeping me here online for the past 8 months. That is excellent. Thank you again, Vainglory TX, for those 10 gift subs you gifted earlier. I very much appreciate that. Thank you, thank you. And Salamander says, if we evolved from apes, how are apes still around? Because species split into different populations, Salamander UK. We did not evolve from modern apes. We share a common ancestor with them. We can talk about that in a minute, Salamander. Give me just a second here. And you can see the flickering here, buddy. That's not good. Here. Give me a second. I adjusted the ISO on the camera. That might have something to do with it. Does that help? It might still be a little bit visible, but that should hopefully... way better. Okay. Good. We'll keep it there for now, or maybe we'll try one more click. That seems worse. There we go. We'll keep it there for now. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah, good stuff. Yeah. I'm still kind of learning how all these things work. I never actually tried to do anything in camera before to get the stream to look the way it does. I just started on that on Friday. IOS helped me with it, and there's still some kinks to work out, clearly. Anyway, Cooking Fat, hello to you. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. And Salamander UK, let's get into your question a little bit. It's funny, like, it kind of gets my hackles up a little bit when somebody asks that question. Asinus OU? Asinus OU, thank you for the follow. Welcome to Paleontologizing. It kind of gets my hackles up a little bit when somebody asks that question, because that's like a classic kind of anti-science creationist canard. I'm glad that's not what you're trying to do here. But here, we have a representation of what we call the Tree of Life, which is, well, it shows how living things are related to one another. As far as we can tell, all life on Earth comes from a single starting point. It all evolved from one ancestral species, something bacteria-like, about 3.8 billion years ago. And now I'll jump to us, Homo sapiens, over here. This is such a cool tool. So there's us. And you'll see within our family there are three species. Chimpanzees, humans, and bonobos. We share a common ancestor with chimps and bonobos. We diverged from them about 6 million years ago. And so if you were to go back 6 million years ago, there was one common ancestor for all three of these. So if you want to call that an ape, then I guess you could say that we evolved from apes. But I think a lot of people make the mistake thinking that, like, oh, we evolved directly from chimps or bonobos or maybe gorillas over here or something. And that's just not the case. We share a common ancestor with them. So yeah, yeah. Does that make sense? And Vanglar says, the microphone has high output. The radio waves can cause interference with camera capture rates. I don't think it's that, Vainglory. I've been using the same mic for years now, and I've never really had that issue before. I think it's more that I'm using these new LED lights. And there's... The camera is if the... something to do with the frame rate or the... I don't actually know. I'm not an expert in digital photography. But something like that. Yeah. And Gary says, it was a single-celled organism? If you go back to the origin of all life, yes, Gary. Yeah. But yeah. Yeah. Should we talk a little bit more about this? Well, first, let's do... Well, no. Let's do this first. Let's see if we can find a decent video on human ancestry. Let's see. Let's take a look at this real quick from National Geographic. They usually do pretty decent stuff. I probably have to get rid of the subtitles, though, because National Geographic, when these videos go up on YouTube later, sometimes, like, it'll get flagged. So we're going to get rid of the audio for the VOD track and reverse the video here.
Before industry, agriculture, and civilization, the world stage was set for one creature's unprecedented rise. The story of humanity's evolution
began about 7 million
years ago, when the human lineage broke away from that of chimpanzees.
Yep. And there we go. Human lineage, Sahelanthropus. I'm not familiar with this one. Ardipithecus. Kadaba, Ardipithecus ramidus. Anyway. So yeah, it was... I guess it would have been about 6 to 7 million years ago that our split with the chimpanzee lineage happened. But that means we share a common ancestor with them.
Over time, an ensemble cast of over 20 early human species, or hominins, came to the fore. Most
There we go. Australopithecus, Lucy, is one of the most famous of those. You've got Homo habilis, Homo heidelbergensis, Homo erectus, and Homo sapiens right there. And we might be kind of a hybrid of two earlier Homo species, which is really interesting. But yeah. And Salamander says, yeah, it's just my head could not get around how we evolved. But I was never good in school and was probably playing truant at the time. Salamander, this is not something unique to you. Holy cow, don't blame yourself. This is the reason I'm streaming here, you know? Natural history, in particular evolution, is one of those fields that is not very well covered in schools. Especially not in the US, but usually not very well either in the UK. And so, it's my pleasure to, you know, help elucidate this for you a little bit. You know, my whole purpose on Twitch is to do science outreach, so this is 100% what I am here for. I'm glad you asked your question, and, yeah. Here. Let's
became
continue.
Extinct, while others might have been ancestors to today's humans. Each species exhibited varying degrees.
And let's see, Filthy Badger says, not at all in Ireland. I'm completely oblivious to it all. Really? You weren't taught this at all in Ireland? Interesting, Filthy Badger. I know Ireland is a very, well, parts of Ireland at least, are usually thought of as like very Catholic. And here in the US, at least, in Catholic schools, usually evolution is taught even better than it is in public schools. Like, there, I know scientists who have, like, people, scientists who are not religious, maybe, but they send their kids to Catholic school because they know they'll get a good science education in Catholic school. Better than in public schools. The creationists have less of an influence on Catholic schools than they have on American public schools. You know? The, like, state-run free schools. So, yeah, it's taken me 58 years to ask the question, so nice to have someone ask. You bet, Salamander UK. It's wonderful to have you here. Holy cow. Yeah. And that's interesting, Tommy Plotkin. Huh. That is true of most Americans, though. Most Americans. No, you're not from the US of A, Tommy Plotkin, but, yeah, most Americans don't ever get to learn about evolution until university. Till college, you know? Yeah. Was taught by priests and nuns, so they would never teach it. Filthy, but that's interesting. The Catholic Church has been okay with evolution for a long time at this point. Like.
Really spectacular, spared no expense.
And Golganek, thank you
Golganek
for
gifted
gifting
additional
Salamander
one
UK.
sub to Salamander underscore UK.
I
They have
appreciate
given
you, Golganek.
393 gift subs in the channel.
That is very thoughtful of you. And your track record here is absurdly generous, Golganek. Thank you for the support. And thank you, Tommy Plotticus, for
Golganek
that gift
gifted a tier
sub.
one sub to Eslavani.
Really appreciate that. Yeah. Good stuff. I often see things that aren't there when I'm very tired. That's true of all of us, Fall Machine. Yeah. Yeah. And Caravan says, in my New York State Public School. City? Spell city with an S. New York State Public School. We learned about human evolution in sixth grade, mainly watching old National Geographic documentaries on the leakies. Yeah, good. It's an issue in the US where like evolution is very frequently not taught in schools. And it's a rotten shame because it's the fundamental unifying principle in biology, you know? It would be like trying to teach chemistry and not being allowed to talk about atoms or the periodic table, you know? Trying to teach biology without evolution, it just doesn't work. Nothing makes sense. It falls apart, you know? It's the foundational thing. Living things change over time, you know? That's what biology is all about. So, yeah. And Catatoon, welcome back to you. It's good to have you here. Yeah, here. Let's continue.
Degrees of human-like physical and behavioral traits, such as large brains.
You know what? And I can find you a better one here. Let's find a better video. I'm not an expert on this kind of thing. Dinosaurs are what I actually study and what I publish on and everything. But here we go. Let's take a look at this right here. This is going to be a longer video, but this is important to talk about. And these folks make really excellent videos. I think you'll like it. And there you go, Tommy Politicus. Yeah. Yeah.
Explaining the origin.
And cooking fat. Yeah, we're, I mean, conversation about evolution and religion, it can become controversial. People get heated about it. But we're here just to talk about the science, you know? That's the wonderful thing about science is when science is done right, it doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter what country you're from, what language you speak, what your cultural background is, what your personal religious beliefs, if any, happen to be. Science is science. It's international. It's supposed to be independent of all that stuff, ideally. And that's the tack that we try and take here too, you know? So no matter what your background is, no matter what your personal convictions or religious beliefs or anything like that, you know, hopefully we can agree on some things like, you know, this is a really cool planet that we live on and we'd like to learn more about it. If you agree with me on that, because for everyone watching, then let's proceed, you know? Let's do it. Science is for everyone. There we go.
Emergence of key traits that distinguish species.
Okay, let's start from the beginning. Got a few seconds in before a tangent.
Explaining the origins of key traits that distinguish species has long been one of biology's fundamental quests.
Yep. Oh, and we'll get into that in a minute.
That's especially
badger.
True for our own species. If we look at humans, as a biologist would any animal, certain features stand out. Our big brains, the way we get around on two legs instead of four, and the way we use our free hands to make tools. Each of those three traits marks an enormous difference between us and our primate relatives.
I've never been to Africa, Tanarim. No,
but
not yet.
When did they evolve?
I'd love to go.
And in what order?
Wonderful dinosaur fossils in Africa.
The quest to understand our past has revealed much about the evolution of these features.
And Jonathan Thistle, if you've got actual science questions, I'm here for you.
A great transition from apes to humans.
You know, that's what I'm all about, so.
It was many years after Charles Darwin had published his theory of evolution that he finally addressed the question, what about us?
He speculated that we are descended from a common ancestor we share with African apes. The hope was that some geologists or paleontologists would one day recover the fossils that would settle the question.
And that was kind of a big step. Like, it, chimpanzees and gorillas and bonobos were not very well known in Darwin's day. There were only like a couple of specimens like that in all of England. I think there was maybe like one or two chimp specimens, and Richard Owen had dibs on those. I don't know if Darwin ever actually got to examine them. He'd heard about them, and he said those look superficially very human-like. But I'm sure he'd seen diagrams and stuff, but I don't know if he ever actually got to examine one until later on. But it was a bold statement that he was making. It's like, hey, I think those might be close relatives to us. And science is all about, you know, testing ideas, putting your money where your mouth is, saying, I could be right or I could be wrong, but this is what I think. Have at it, everybody. If my idea doesn't comport with, you know, with the evidence, then throw it away. And, yeah, here. And Cooking Fat says, was Lucy really the missing link or just a poor choice of words? There isn't really a missing link, Cooking Fat, because, like, the more links you find, the more missing links you create. You know? It's like if we have humans and then we have earlier like ape-like species and then you find one in between, instead of having one gap here, suddenly you have two gaps. And then if you find one for each of those, then suddenly you have four gaps. And this is kind of how it goes on and on and on, as you'll see with this. So Lucy, Australopithecus afarensis does seem to be on the direct line to humans. So if that's what you meant by missing link, then I guess, yes, she is a... That species does seem to be a direct ancestor, as I understand it. But yeah, yeah. Let's continue.
Fossils are essential evidence when putting together an evolutionary history. But in Darwin's day, and for many decades after, few early human fossils had been found anywhere.
Yep.
Anthropologists Lewis and Mary Leakey thought Darwin was right about Africa. So they searched for early human fossils in places like Tanzania's Olduvai Gorge.
Yep. By the way, this was a bold thing at the time. Prior to the work of the Leakeys, there were a lot of people, especially like creationists, who were very against the idea that humanity started in Africa. Murph, thank you for the 5 gift subs there. I really appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you. Good stuff.
Murph just changed things with those 5 gift subs.
Appreciate that very much. Look how close we are to our sub goal. Excellent. Yeah, there were a lot of people who were very against the idea that humanity started in Africa. A lot of them were creationists who were kind of opposed to the idea of evolution at all. But then there were some of those same people were very against the idea because they were racist against Africans. And they're like, well, Africa can't possibly be the cradle of humanity because, you know, I'm a big old racist against people from Africa. Like, and that actually influenced some people in science as well. So there was a lot of pushback against this idea that Africa was the birthplace of humanity. So yeah.
Here, they found abundant stone tools. But for the longest time, the bones they sought eluded them.
For almost 3 decades, all the Leakeys found were tools. Tools, tools everywhere, but not their makers. But all that finally changed the morning of July 17th, 1959.
On a hill Mary had walked by countless times.
I missed something, but that's okay.
Something caught her eye. Poking through the eroding sediment was a huge upper jaw. Together, she and Lewis carefully extracted bones from the skull of an early hominid.
Yeah. Exciting stuff.
Geochemists analyzed the sediment layer it was buried in and determined this hominid had lived a stunning 1.76 million years ago. Remarkably, the very next year, the Leakeys made another discovery. They designated it Olduvai hominid number 7.
Yeah.
It too
this
was
isn't Lucy yet, Jonathan Thistle.
Years old.
But Lucy's
coming. The recovered skull pieces and finger and wrist bones led them to conclude it was a separate species of early hominid. So there were at least 2 different evolving lineages of humans alive at this time.
So lineages are, you know, that's like separate lines. And they've evolved and they're starting to evolve in different directions like this. They're no longer sharing genes. They've become different species.
These discoveries helped swing the focus of human paleontology to Africa.
Yep.
Detailed casts of these and many other
fossils. Oh, yeah. This is the Valley Life Sciences building in Berkeley, California, just down the road from me here in the beautiful, sunny San Francisco Bay Area. Although it doesn't really look like this today. Let's see. Yeah, this is a view from the Berkeley Hills right now, and it is foggy and rainy today, which is kind of out of the ordinary, but really nice. I'm enjoying it. I wish I could spend some time outside right now, but it's also nice to be here streaming. Anyway, yeah. But this building is in Berkeley, California. This is the same building that UCMP is in, the University of California Museum of Paleontology, is in this same building. So when you hear me talking about, like, oh yeah, I spent the morning at the museum today, this is the building I'm talking about. The Valley Life Sciences building.
Fossil find. Detailed casts of these and many other fossil finds are kept at the Human Evolution Research Center
at the University of California at Berkeley.
Dr. Tim White, the center's director, has been involved with many of the important hominid discoveries of the past 4 decades.
Clearly it was a hominid.
I asked him what the current view is of the Leakeys' first discoveries.
Well, I guess after chasing the toolmaker for so many years, they initially thought, oh, we've found the toolmaker, but it turns out this large crest, the huge back teeth of this, show that it's on a side branch of human evolution. Probably not the toolmaker, but fortunately, the next
This guy's a trippy. He is a linear.
Discovery,
yeah.
Was older by hominid number 7, with a cranium much larger in size and a face much smaller in size, and probably the maker of these very primitive stone tools from the very bottom of Olduvai Gorge.
The early humans found at Olduvai were bipedal toolmakers, with brains not as big as ours, but larger than those of modern chimps, our closest primate relatives. So all of these traits must have evolved between 1.8 million years ago and whenever the human and chimp line separated.
That thing is amazing to watch, go through that. It's pretty cool.
And when did that happen? Yeah. At that point, no one could say.
Yeah, and Tim White's a really interesting guy, Lenina, for sure. I've spoken with him on a number of occasions, and yeah, he's interesting. When he learned that I study dinosaurs, he's like, oh. But we still had a good conversation. This was years ago. Registered to be fossilized, Dorky on TV. I don't think that's what that little dot means on the driver's license, but maybe you live in a different state than I do, Dorky on TV. Welcome back. It's good to have you here.
But then Alan Wilson and colleagues here at Berkeley developed a revolutionary new way to use biomolecules, including DNA, to estimate the time of that split. Using this approach, researchers have estimated that humans and chimps have been evolving independently for almost 7 million years.
Yep, and that's what we saw here too. This says 6, but it's probably like 6.8 or something. Chimps, bonobos, and humans split more than 6 million years ago.
Really spectacular. Spared noise.
Thank you, Golganak, for gifting Cooking Fat.
Golganak gifted a tier 1 sub to Cooking Fat. They have given 394 gifts
really
subs in the
that.
Channel.
Good stuff.
DNA tells us that our lineage goes back several million years before the Olduvai fossils. Mm-hmm. What DNA can't tell us is where and when the traits that distinguish us, like bipedality, first emerged.
Yeah, walking on two legs. When did that start?
Only fossils and their ancient environments can address those questions.
That's why fossils are so important.
Eastern Africa is a fossil treasure trove because of the geological forces that have created the rift valleys that scar the region.
Isn't that cool, reanimated? Yeah. I think that's a good representation of humanity.
Volcanoes associated with this rifting regularly blanketed the region with ash that included radioactive elements, the steady decay of which allows geologists to accurately date sediment layers and the fossils within them. Paleontologist Don Johansson remembers vividly the first time he visited the Hadar region of Ethiopia. 1,000 miles north of Olduvai, it has exposed sediments that are over 1 million years older.
Paleontologist, the hills are painted. Yeah, those are the different,
of this escarpment,
different
and it
rock
just
layers.
Unfolded, and there it was. All of the sediments getting deeper and deeper and deeper. I could not wait to get down there. The driving force was find something.
And then we walked out there.
Johansson recently shared with fellow paleontologist Neil Shubin his memories of the day he discovered the first small bone fragment of one of the most famous fossil skeletons ever found.
You know, my best recollection is that it was right in this area. And I looked at it and almost instantaneously said, that's a hominid.
Just a fragment of elbow that led to the skeleton.
Yeah.
An international team of scientists helped Johansson recover almost half the bones of an individual who had lived 3.2 million years ago. They call
her
Lucy.
Lucy.
Finding Lucy was really the first step in this very long process of description, investigation, evaluation, hypothesis testing, trying to figure out where in the world she sat, like we are.
There's an old, an earlier Tim White right there, a younger Tim White. He doesn't have so much hair anymore.
We are on the tree, on the human family tree.
This is the Lucy skeleton found by Don Johansson in Ethiopia. She's 3.2 million years old and very representative of Australopithecus, the next earlier phase of human evolution. And they are bipeds, relatively small brains.
Lucy's like 3 feet tall.
So far, of any stone tool use.
Same height as me.
So stone tool use comes in much later than Lucy and her brethren.
With early Homo.
What can we tell about this creature from the fossils?
When we look down here into the pelvis, we see evidence for bipedal walking, a commitment to walking on two legs that is very different from what we see among great apes. So when we look at a chimpanzee in the hip, we see the hip bones behind.
Lucy, you got some splaining to do. Go, Murph.
They're long, they're tall, the creature's back. Whereas in a human, our hip bone is much broader front to back, much shorter, and wrapping around the side.
There you go, Charlie's
these
dragons.
Muscles that control pelvic tilt during walking in an advantageous position. Then we can ask the question, is Lucy more like a human or more like a chimp? She has a very short blade on the pelvis, much more like a human. She has muscle attachments, much more like a human. It's a basically biped's architecture, and that's how we know that she walked on two legs. But there was a little bit of controversy even after that. Some people said, well, how can we really be sure about that?
And how can we be sure?
Because we found these incredible things in northern Tanzania, older than Lucy, sandwiched between layers of volcanic ash.
What's important about that, chat? Little quiz for you. Sandwiched between layers of volcanic ash. Why is that important? Why is that something to get excited about? Why do you want fossils to be sandwiched between layers of volcanic ash? And we're getting... I don't even need to go for the next 12 seconds with that. You are correct, chat. Ding, ding, ding. When you find a fossil, either a hominid fossil or a dinosaur fossil that's sandwiched between layers of volcanic ash, one layer above, one layer below, that means you can date it. You can tell how old it is by dating the ash radiometrically. Which I think Tim White is gonna talk about here. Yeah.
It's not what... Older than Lucy, sandwiched between layers of volcanic ash.
Yeah.
It's not what you think. It's not bones.
Here we go.
There was a volcanic eruption 3.75 million years ago. Volcanic ash came down on the Serengeti Plain.
Oh, shoot. Maybe he's not going to talk about dating. He's going to talk about the footprints, isn't he? If we were talking about dinosaurs here, then volcanic ash would be really important because you can find what we call zircons in them. Zircons are these tiny little crystals that have radioactive isotopes trapped inside, like a time capsule. And you can take those radioactive isotopes out and, basically, like, count the ratio in there. You can tell how long it's been since that eruption took place.
Because though they died out so
Thank
long
you,
ago,
Dago.
Their fossil bones remain, so we know just what they were like.
Appreciate
and can
your
even
support.
Sculpt them into still, or rather, extinct life.
Good
hope
stuff, Risa Dago.
Had a good winter holiday of your choice.
I certainly did. I hope you did too, Risa Dago. It's good to have you back. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, 20 points away from the goal now. Yeah, Lenny, we're gotta be really, really close to our, you're talking about our Partner Plus goal. Yeah, yeah. Anyway, I guess what they're talking about here with regard to bipedality, walking on two legs, is the footprints. Here.
And animals walked across.
Yeah.
The ash hardened and was buried. In the 1970s, I was lucky enough to be with Mary Leakey out in this area, and we found the trails of hominid individuals left as they walked across that volcanic ash. millions of years ago.
Pretty cool.
It's an amazing, like a snapshot of time. They went for meters and meters and meters. There are no knuckle marks, no handprints, just bipedal footprints that look more or less like what you and I would leave on a beach.
Yep. Pretty cool. Imagine the excitement of that discovery.
Human feet, we're all used to them, but they're really strange.
Yeah, they're bizarre.
Our big toe is in line with our other toes. We don't have
Utah
a grasping
raptors,
big toe.
The most dangerous dinosaur around.
Here, Feist. Take my prime again. 33 months of prime there. I appreciate you, Feist. Thank you very, very much. Thank you for supporting this channel with that prime. Good stuff.
So we have arches, transverse and longitudinal in our feet. All these features are present at 3.75 million years ago in Australopithecus.
So Australopithecus pushes us all the way back to 3.7 million years or older. She's small-brained, not using tools to our knowledge, but walking upright. So that's telling us that walking upright is yet still an earlier trait. What do we know about that?
Happy holidays to you too, Slumber.
We didn't know very much about it because Lucy and her species only went back to 3.75. So to take the next step back in time, we had to find older fossils.
In that brief moment, we alone are the only species to comprehend and appreciate the great dinosaurs.
Hrothgar.
Small brain, not using tools. Is he talking about me?
Oh, Hrothgar. Look at you using that Twitch tool right there. That is some complex tool use bespeaking significant intelligence. Especially subscribing to a channel like this, I gotta say, not to toot my own horn. But thank you, Hrothgar, for your ongoing support and your good humor. Appreciate you.
Just 50 miles south of where Lucy was found, there are exposed rock layers reaching back 6 million years. This is where Tim White and a large international team of geologists, paleontologists, and archaeologists have focused their combined efforts since the early 1980s.
What we wanted to do was to plumb the unknown, to figure out what came before the Lucy species.
For a decade, what they'd come for largely eluded them, until...
A graduate student at the time, Johannes Haile Selassie, found two little pieces from the palm of the hand, just this bone here. And these little pieces, he picked up and said, this looks like a hominid.
The excitement of this and other early finds quickly gave way to a disciplined search for more. And there was indeed much more to find.
Hand, foot, arm, leg, teeth, skull, head to toe, we had coverage of a creature nobody had ever seen before.
Pretty cool. Pretty
cool. We named her Ardi for the genus Ardipithecus. The species is Ramidus. And it's really a skeleton that is representative of the earliest known phase of human evolution.
And how old is she?
She's 4.4 million years old. We know that.
She might not look be the oldest known anymore. This video came out, what, 10 years ago? Something like that? 9 years ago. It could very well be that we've got older hominids now, kind of plugging the gap between Ardi and the ancestor between humans and chimps, our common ancestor with chimps. But I'm not sure. Yeah, I don't know what the current state of paleoanthropology is with regard to this question, but yeah. If we have any paleoanthropologists watching and lurking right now, I'm not going to claim that this video is up to date. Very well might not be. We might have even older fossils nowadays, which would be really cool.
Because these bones were all found...
And they're not found in a grave, no, Murph.
Volcanic
no.
horizons, both dated to 4.4 million years ago.
And what I was talking earlier about with those ash dates, there you go. Really, really cool that you've got these sequential volcanic eruptions like that. These wouldn't be like probably not hyper catastrophic events. It's just like, you know, every once in a while a volcano goes off, you know. Here, I guess it was what, 3,000 years in between, 30,000 years, whatever. Let's see, that would be 4,416,000, 4 million. Yeah, so 3,000 years apart, volcanic eruptions there.
So that's more than a million years older than Lucy.
It was stepping into that black hole beyond Lucy that nobody'd been able to step into before.
Removing Artie from her 4 million year resting place was a real challenge. Her bones were ready to turn to dust.
That little hill had to be excavated a millimeter at a time. We had to use chemical hardeners on her.
Yeah. Which, that's typical in dinosaur paleontology, you know? That chemical hardener is probably some sort of polyvinyl acetate glue. That's probably very similar to the Vinac or the Butvar or the other kinds of PVA like B72 or acryloid that we use in the field on dinosaur fossils. Yeah, they're not using a mustard bottle here, but chemical hardener, aka glue. Yeah, there you go, Charlie's Dragon. PVA glue, polyvinyl acetate glue. It's basically like a kind of plastic pellet that you dissolve in acetone, basically in like nail polish remover. And yeah, it makes a wonderful kind of penetrating glue. The acetone, you know, since it's very, what's the opposite of viscous? It's very thin. It seeps down in and it carries the plastic with it. And then it evaporates and it leaves the plastic inside. Pretty cool. Yeah. And Morris63, thank you for that follow. Welcome. Thank you for the follow there, Mora. Welcome to Paleontologizing. Yeah. And isn't that wood glue PVA? PVA? Yeah, wood glue is a type of PVA. Krautland? Yes, indeed. Yeah. And Phoenix the Archaeologist says, well, we have Ororin, 6.1 million, and Toumai, 7 million, as the contenders for the title of Oldest Ancestor. Very cool, Phoenix. Thank you. See? Somebody in chat knows this better than I do. That's wonderful. Thank you, Phoenix. I appreciate that. And Plockman's Mustard says, paleoanthropology has yet to discover the wonders of the mustard bottle. Evidently. They've got this instead.
Extract her in plaster jackets. And then work on each bone under a...
And they just did half jackets, but okay.
Yeah. Binocular microscope with a needle.
Yeah.
To clean the encasing sediment from the soft bone underneath.
It's pretty typical.
But what we got as a result of that is a really unrivaled look at the anatomy of a very ancient hominid. We could see the muscle attachments on the finger bones. We could see the scratches on the teeth. It's beautiful anatomy.
With some real surprises, especially below the neck.
There was an extension in the lower pelvis that showed that she was a climber. In the foot, a large toe that stuck out to the side of the foot, the first time this is ever seen in a hominid. Even though all other primates have this. She is this peculiar mosaic of traits, capable of bipedality on the ground.
Turkey says, do we have more or fewer teeth than our ancestors? We have fewer teeth than our ancestors. That's why a lot of us are still born with what we call wisdom teeth that need to be removed. That's a holdover from our ancestors who had more teeth. Some of us, of course, never had those to start with, you know? That's a mutation. I don't have any wisdom teeth. Never did. Or I have like one quarter of one, and it's small enough that it'll probably never have to be removed. But, yeah. Yeah. And where were these primates found? In Eastern Africa. Attractive cactus. These were from Ethiopia.
But also climbing ability.
And that's not a Neanderthal. Neanderthals are much later. Neanderthals are like straight up people, S.V. Hargan. Neanderthals look like this. Like this handsome fella here. Neanderthals. Some of us actually have Neanderthal DNA. Most people who are not from most people who have ancestors from outside of Africa, after the human exodus from Africa. That's the way to put it. I'm sorry, I'm being really clumsy with all this stuff. I'm not a paleoanthropologist. But yeah, like if your more recent ancestors came from outside of Africa, because originally we all come from Africa, you know, then chances are you have some Neanderthal DNA. I've got a great deal myself. That 23andMe test, or it was Ancestry.com test that I took, it showed a pretty crazy amount of Neanderthal DNA for me. I'm like in the 99th percentile or something. Yeah. So yeah, and you've been to that museum, June 1? Very cool. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. And what do we have, webbing between our fingers and toes? You do, Sophie? Do you mean we, or do you mean you? But yeah, yeah. And what percentage of the DNA is Neanderthal for me? I don't... I'm sure it's probably less than 1%, but I don't know. Yeah. You were 99% Neanderthal. I don't think that's true, Game Plague. Yeah, and Real Men Grow Beards says, you do have quite a pronounced brow, Danny. I'm aware. I'm aware. Look at that. Yeah. I don't know if that's actually a Neanderthal trait, though. It might very distinctly not be. I'm not sure. But yeah, yeah. Anyway, let's continue. So Neanderthals are like 6 million years after this guy. This is Ardipithecus here.
Superior to those seen in later Australopithecus.
You couldn't possibly have expected this.
Nobody could have expected it because you can't predict this from looking at chimps and humans and triangulating. Artie is neither a chimp nor is she a human.
Down.
She is a mosaic, 4.4 million years old. The step beyond Australopithecus.
Oh, sorry. Ardipithecus is 4.4 billion years. 4.4 million years old, not billion. The Earth is only 4.58 billion or whatever. Anyway, yeah, so this is about 4.4 million years before Neanderthals.
A glimpse into that first phase of hominid evolution.
Yeah. And Phoenix says, actually, very recent research shows that Neanderthal genes can be found in modern African peoples. Interesting. So they might have gone into Africa at the same time and or made with sapiens and mixed their DNA and traveled back to Africa. Interesting, Phoenix. Lots of new research going on now? Very cool. Well, I'm glad you're here. I was unaware of this. It's outside my realm of expertise. Yeah. And Casey Snowart says, so are these the missing links that I hear so much about? Or are we still missing that? I really don't like that phrase, missing links, because when you find them, are they still missing? And it's like, I don't know. If you define something by it not being there, what happens when you find it? I really don't like that phrase. And I think most paleontologists, evolutionary biologists, etc., don't like that phrase either, you know? Instead, I guess these were...
Knowing what dinosaurs looked like, we now need to know how they lived.
Mama Bon Bon, thank you for the 31 months. I do really appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you, Mama Bon Bon. 31 months. Hot darn. Thank you, thank you. It's good to have you back. Yeah, well... The funny thing about a missing link, too, is that once you find it, you've just created two new missing links. Like, for every link you put on the chain, you could always put another one in between that link and the next links, right? So, yeah. Anyway... Or missing link to prodigal link. Yeah, there you go, Hrothgar. yeah. That's what I've never understood about that term. Yeah. Yeah. It's like a Zeno's paradox kind of thing, you know? You familiar with Zeno's paradox? It's a lot like that. And Gene Wentz says, not to be confused with the missing links. That one has been found and is back at the zoo. Good, Gene Wentz. Uh, Oh, apparently they made a movie about that? The Missing Links. Oh, no. Yeah.
I can see that my, 50,000 a year has been well spent.
Holy cow, Golganek. Getting 29 months. You'll be there one of these days, Golganek. Thank you so much. Tier 3 support there from Golganek. Thank you for everything you do, Golganek. Appreciate you more than you know. That's excellent. Yeah. Getting us ever closer to our Partner Plus goal here. Excellent. Yeah. And Kudos Buddha says, I don't understand how that vehicle turns. Shoot, I don't either. I guess you'd have to steer using the back. But it's got a shopping cart for wheels. Yeah, I don't know. Beats me. Maybe it can only go straight. Or maybe you have to bank it left and right. You know? I don't know. Probably not a documentary. Unlike this. Let's get back to our documentary here. We're getting close to the end.
Buried along with Artie was fossil evidence of the habitat in which she lived
and
where bipedality evolved. It wasn't what anyone had been expecting. For a long time, scientists predicted that bipedality had evolved in a grassland.
The savanna has always played a big role in people's speculations.
Yeah, there's this idea that, like, oh, you have to stand up to look over the tall grass to see if there's a big cat trying to eat you. Just like we got here. Hello, sweetie pie. Hi, do you want to come make an appearance? Oh, she's awful shy right now. Anyway, I'm being stalked by a cat right now.
And what we had with Artie was evidence from her body and her, indeed her chemistry, as well as evidence from her environment that showed.
How you doing? You want to come say hello? Come here. Hey, come on up here. You gonna play this game again? Here, do you want to come say hello? I know you want some attention right now. Yeah, and you're meowing too. Come here. Yeah, do you want a treat?
Oh, you know that's it.
Let's see if I can get her up. One of these days, I'll have a cat camera here. But, hey, sweetie, look. Come on up here. A noise outside the room. Don't get distracted, look. Ooh. Does that look good to eat? Come on up here. Come on. Do you want to come over here? It really is like herding cats. Come here. She doesn't want to. Sorry to be such a tease about that, chat, but she's not really feeling it right now. Yeah. Oh, come here. Yeah, there you go. Come on up. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. What's up there? What's up there? She did the thing where she reared on her hind legs to look up at the desk. Come here. Come on up. There you go. Yeah. Oh, you're showing your butt to the camera? Yeah. Oh. You're such a sweetheart. Oh, sweetie pie. Yeah. Oh, look at you. Your treat go? Can you find it? I smell it up here, but where is it? I think it's under your back legs. Look over here. Oh, it's right here. Look. There you go. Yeah. Girl. Oh. And there she goes. Well, you have just spotted Sweetie Pie. Big pets from us? I will, Dinosaur Dave, yeah. She is, she's a real sweetheart, Sweetie Pie. You'll also see Minnie Pie and Moon Pie eventually. I'd love to be able to set up an actual cat bed with a cat camera in here, but, yeah. The other two cats are usually asleep when I'm streaming, so one of these days, our schedules are going to line up, and you will see them, too. But yeah, yeah. Yeah, a cat cam. It'll happen, Avalon Angels. I was trying to set up a second camera today, this one right here, and just wasn't working. I don't know what's wrong with my setup, but it just wasn't working. The computer won't even recognize it. Anyway, and welcome back, Lumiere. It's good to have you here. Welcome back to Paleontologizing. Cat tree might be more effective. I don't have room for a cat tree, real man. But I could get a heated pad. You know? We'll figure that out. Anyway. And the cats are the landlords. Danny moved in. Exactly, Codali. The cats own the house, you know? Yeah. Let's get back to this. Where were we? We were here.
Was fossil evidence of the habitat in which she lived and where bipedality evolved.
And you're welcome, Lumiere.
It wasn't
Thank
what
you for
anyone
being.
Had been expecting. For a long time, scientists predicted that bipedality had evolved in a grassland.
The savanna has always played a big role in people's speculations. And what we had with Artie was evidence from her body, and her, indeed her chemistry, as well as evidence from her environment that showed she was not adapted to an open grassland.
Well, 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 she's back. Hello, Sweetie Pie. Let me reinforce this behavior with another treat, huh? Ooh. We need to get a better camera for you, don't we? So that people can appreciate
producing a fossil hard as rock. Odds of this happening are so slim they are impossible to calculate. But then on top of that, to actually find the fossil makes the world of the dinosaur hunter the world of the long shot.
That's a good Sweetie Pie.
Love that your page is still going strong.
Thank you, Carrie, and I appreciate that. Thank you for the 6 months. It's still going strong, and thanks in part to you. So thank you for that support. Oh, there you go, Sweetie. Good stuff. Oh, look at you. Look at you. Oh, the camera loves you. Yeah. There you go. Let me move my keyboard. Look at this right here. Wow, look at that. Wow. Look there. Yeah. That's a good sweetie pie. Yeah. Thanks for coming up here. Wow, what a treat. What a treat. It's Sweetie Pie stream now, everybody. We're all just participating in it. Look up here. Oh, yeah, what's that? Look at that. Ooh, yeah. Look at all this exciting stuff up here. Don't you just love it? Isn't this great, Sweetie Pie? Oh, yeah, there you go. He's gonna hang out here now? Oh, look at you. Oh, my goodness. Sweetie, this makes me really happy. I hope you're having as much fun as I am. Well, chat, I am delighted. Yeah, what a good place to be, huh? I'm so happy. So happy. Yeah. Oh, and there she goes. Ooh. She's detected some motion outside. She's gonna go investigate. Is a guest in her stream? Exactly, Phoenix. Yeah. Good stuff. And yeah. Claire had made this art piece. Yeah, that looks more like Moon Pie or Mini Pie, but work for Sweetie Pie too. Yeah. And Murph says, do you think if non-avian dinosaurs were around today, we would still talk to them in that pet tone of voice? I do that with extinct dinosaurs now, Murph. With extinct non-avian dinosaurs. Oh, yeah. Oh, look at you. Pretty iguanodon chin. That kind of thing, you know? Yeah. Anyway. Let's get back to our documentary here, shall we?
Savannah existence, even though she had already achieved bipedality.
That evidence included tens of thousands of animal and plant fossils, indicating that she was living in a woodland setting, not an open African savanna. So bipedality evolved while our ancient ancestors were still spending time in the trees.
Pretty cool.
Ardipithecus took away any doubt that bipedality was ancient. And it was so ancient that it preceded, by over a million years, the expansion of the brain, the incorporation of stone tool technology.
We now have thousands of hominid fossils from the past 6 million years. They reveal several phases in the biological evolution of humans.
You have an cool early stuff. Phase, Ardipithecus, whose anatomy allows it to climb in the woodlands and walk on two legs.
Artie?
We see Australopithecus as the next phase. Lucy, a representative of this. It's a committed biped with a small brain, but still big teeth for chewing, big, robust faces. Their niche has expanded beyond Ardipithecus. They're in more open habitats. They're found throughout the African continent. And then the third phase of human evolution is our own genus, the genus Homo. And here we have a creature that really is a technological primate, depending more and more on culture.
Yeah.
Stone tools allow early humans to compete first with scavengers and then with predators. They broaden their diets and ultimately their geographic range, leaving Africa. Recently, in the Republic of Georgia, hominid fossils.
That's not Georgia State, that's the country of Georgia. in
fossils were discovered that are as old as the Olduvai fossils. They include the most complete early Homo skull ever found.
Very cool.
That is going to give us insight into the biology of our ancestors, the ancestors of Homo sapiens. And it's a great illustration of how paleontology is not a dead science. Paleontology is the
How could anyone say a dead science? Goodness, it's one of the most vibrant sciences there is, in my opinion. Yeah.
Great illustration of how paleontology is not a dead science. Paleontology is the science by which we learn about our past, how we became human.
Yep, there you go.
And what that science shows is that, like all animals, we have a long evolutionary history.
Just as four-legged animals evolved from fish ancestors and birds evolved from dinosaur ancestors over a series of small steps over a long geological time span, we evolved from small-brained quadrupedal apes over a long time span that is now well documented in the fossil record.
Pretty cool. Pretty cool. I'll give you a link to this video right here. I enjoyed that. I hope you did too. There's the link right there in the chat. And a dead science would be fidget spinner construction. There you go, Gene Lin, yeah. The development of the car didn't end with Henry Ford. Exactly. It didn't start with Henry Ford either. But, yeah. Anyway, I hope, Salamander UK, are you still here? We started that video because of a question you asked, but, I hope everybody enjoyed that. It's good stuff. Always a pleasure hearing Tim White speak. Yeah, Lenina, yeah. Oh, and you are still here, Salamander. Excellent. Yeah. That reminds me of... This was a... An interesting series here. I don't know if any of you have seen this before, but... It's a little bit hokey, but still interesting. I can find a trailer for it. It was called Conspiracy Road Trip. And the premise is there are... Well, here, let's just start it from the beginning. I think they'll introduce the concept at the beginning. But Tim White appears in this right here, and he's got a really neat part. But take a look at this.
I'm Andrew Maxwell, a comedian. But in this series, I'm on a serious mission. To explore the world of the conspiracy theorist. Tonight, it's religious fundamentalists, people who believe every detail of their holy books is fact. And science is out to destroy God.
Yeah. Oh no, I'd better not get copyright struck from this cake song.
I'm gonna travel with these diehard creationists to the west coast of America.
Andrew.
Phil.
Where nearly 50% of people are on their side.
Andrew, come on in.
Hi, I'm Sam.
To try and understand where they're coming from. For them, humans and dinosaurs lived happily side by side. Noah squeezed every living creature onto his
ark.
Noah's ark was specifically designed by God.
And evolution is a pack of lies told to rid the world of God.
Hmm. Anyway, so let's go to the part with Tim White here at Berkeley.
Can we focus on what we're doing in about 30 seconds?
Yeah,
which is a meeting, probably a professor from Berkeley University, who's
going
to eat you alive due to the fact that you know you spent majority of time thinking about how hot guys are.
Can I just say something? I stand assured that you have got this under control.
You're going to go to sleep, Duno? Thanks for being here.
That he and Billy the chimp are distant.
There's VLSB again.
He's certain that human life began with Adam and a spare rib, Eve.
So what the biblical position is on all this is that there was a man and a woman at the very beginning, Adam and Eve.
And Casey Snower, it depends on how you ask the question, but, well, again, this is a British show, so he didn't mean the West Coast of the U.S., he meant the U.S. in general. About 50% of people are fundamentalists. And depending on how you ask the question, that's roughly true. There hasn't really been very good methodology in how those questions are asked. But yeah, according to some counts, it is like 50% of Americans are religious fundamentalists. And, you know, basically not on board with the idea of science. But yeah, it still feels high, but maybe I'm out of touch. Yeah, I mean, it depends how you ask it, Casey Snower. That's the thing, is that it's interesting, like, even when we talk about evolution, if we talk about evolution of one species of dinosaur into another, most people, even most religious fundamentalists, will be okay with that. But when you start talking about human evolution, and to a scientist, that's the same thing as evolution of dinosaurs or evolution of fruit flies or something. Because, you know, it's all evolution. But to some people, they think about these things in entirely different ways. Like, you know, like, oh, you know, I'm okay with one species evolving into another, but leave humans out of that, though, you know? It might not make any sense logically, but emotionally, that's how they feel, you know? Yeah. Fundamentalists just want to have fun. There you go, Andy. Yeah, yeah. Anyway, that's one of the reasons I really liked this series, is this particular episode here. It, like, they get a bus full of conspiracy theorists, and then they just, like, drive them around to different sites and, like, ask them, what do you think about this? And they actually get to talk to experts in the field. So here it's paleontology, geology, paleoanthropology. And it really, like, humanizes those people to those of us on the outside. Those of us watching who might be inclined to say, like, oh, well, you know, these people are nutcases and, you know, I just want to completely write them off. Well, with this series, it, you know, you really see them as fellow human beings with, you know, they might be flawed in their logic, their reasoning, but, like, sometimes you can kind of tell why they came to these conclusions in the first place. Sometimes there's some sort of trauma there or something like that. It's interesting stuff, you know? Anyway,
people.
Take a look.
And there are common ancestors that if we were in the Garden of Eden, we could have gone and shook hands with. We're all part of that same genealogy.
I always thought Adam and Eve weren't meant to be taken literally.
There you go, Lenina, yeah.
So we're going to meet Professor of Evolutionary Biology, Tim White, for a shake of our family tree.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah.
Wassalamu alaikum.
And maybe I can find a version of this with subtitles here. Give me a second. Let's see here. I think. Yes, we are in luck.
I always thought Adam and Eve weren't meant to be taken literally. So we're going to meet Professor of Evolutionary Biology,
Utah
Tim
Raptors,
White.
Utah Raptors, the most dangerous dinosaur around.
Dark Tarkonis, thank you for the 34 months of support. I really appreciate that. Yeah. And CM says, what's your favorite dinosaur? I've got a bunch, CM. And I have a command for that, too. Here, I'll talk about a few of them in a few minutes, but let's watch this real quick, too. Yeah. Yeah.
For a shake of our family tree.
Nice to meet you. This is Tim. Wassalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum.
What are your ideas on human evolution?
Well, we have Adam and Eve initially. Okay, and then, so, pick me up if I'm wrong. But this is, you know, because it would be a lot easier with the Bible in front of me. But we then have, so their children were Cain and Abel, is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just checking with everyone just to make sure I'm not making any errors here.
Yeah, Cain and Abel, two guys. Interesting. But yeah.
So from there, they then had children from there.
So Cain and Abel had a child?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no. Okay, well, right.
Cain and Abel were two dudes. They can't have a kid. Mm-hmm.
Kid. Yeah, exactly. Basically.
There's also like a lot of drama between the people on the bus during this too, and I think that's kind of the appeal of the show to like a general audience. It's like, oh, drama and infighting, but.
Right.
Cain and Abel were two dudes. They can't have a kid. Mm-hmm. Kid.
Yeah, exactly. Basically.
The point is, you're saying that DNA has changed that much in 6,500 years, that 6,500 years ago, it was genetically viable to have it off with your sister.
But the Bible is very clear then when it comes to the time of Moses, that it then forbids brothers and sisters to marry. And the Bible is very specific about the reason for that. It says they're not too close.
Is that true for Ollie?
Phil, I just I'm not trying to challenge you at all. I just would like to ask a question in as much as, obviously I believe the Bible
is so better. Sweet during this, you know?
But you're saying that, like, in the beginning, God made mankind, so why are they getting close and then he just kind of stop it further on down the line? I don't get that.
As we're heading downhill genetically, it comes to a point in time where God says, look, your genetics are too close, you should no longer marry your brother or your sister.
There are some hair-raising ideas about DNA and incest being bandied about. Tim, however, is just interested in the evidence. He's dug up hundreds of human-like skulls from the same valley in Ethiopia. Carbon dating has put them at different ages.
Not carbon dating.
But can Sam put them in chronological order by sight alone?
So let's go. Let's take that one. That one is right from...
What is that?
That's from a million years old.
Oh, it's like this. No, so these are the eyes. Well,
that's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
So I suppose it would probably go over here because the where the brow comes up is more similar to this one.
You got it. Careful now. They may not be the real fossils, but there's only one copy in the United States, so we don't want to break it.
I'm probably going to put this one here, I think.
Now, you got the.
I really love this because here you've got Tim White talking to what should be a hostile audience to him, and he's able to involve them and get them interested and kind of put them in the driver's seat so they can figure this out for themselves with the fossils. This is really, really cool. You know, I love this as a method of science communication here, you know?
I'm probably going to put this one here, I think.
Now, you got the order exactly correct, mm-hmm. because what we find is that's the closest to the top. Oh, you got one out of order, the Kenyan one. So that's just,
is that right, though?
That's good, good. And then we get back to 4.5 million years ago. Now, remember, I talked about one valley in Africa, one stack of rocks. Now, according to the idea that humans haven't changed and that we should find humans all the way back, now we've got a problem in terms of the evidence because we don't find any of those guys down in the early records. And we don't find any of these in the later records. So it looks like that model, where it should be all humans all the way back, fails.
It says a lot. I mean, yeah. I understand what your logic is. I understand how you got here. I haven't seen a case of natural selection making an organism change from one species to another species.
And shoot, if this thing sort of thing were taught properly in schools, then, you know, this guy here would have seen that. I can think of a bunch of examples of this. We have examples of this in dinosaurs, you know? But, like, this sort of stuff doesn't get taught in schools, which is really frustrating.
Neither have I, because we don't live long enough, bro.
Once again, I think that's an excellent...
We don't live long enough. The neat thing we've got in this fossil record is nearly a... It's not conjecture. It's evidence and reason. We have almost a kilometer of rocks, over a kilometer, yes. And we can actually... ask the question, what do we see when we go back through time?
So in this valley,
and this is what we see.
You're on the wrong end.
Way. I was waiting for somebody to do it. I thought it'd be Blabbermouth, but you got in there first.
Yeah. Hearing all of this is, you know, is ironing. It's just like taking it in. If everybody is coming up with the same conclusion, I don't want to be blinkered.
Then don't be blinkered.
Oh, it stresses my head.
British slang.
Same.
I mean, what would change your mind, honestly?
Nothing. That sounds so narrow-minded.
No, it doesn't sound narrow-minded.
It does, 'cause I don't want to be the person that's like, Okay, so I've just come on this trip for 10 days and nothing you show me is going to change my mind. That is like, whew. But then at the same time, I'm like, it can't. Like, it really can't. Like, I can't even tell you. But it really, it can't, because there's a faith that I have that if I start...
Yeah. Interesting stuff. Anyway, I'll give you a link to this. You can watch it if you'd like to. Yeah, yeah. There's something about... I understand it. You know, there's something about human evolution that a lot of people just... They don't want to understand it. Because it's so close to home. It's something that's so close to our hearts. Like, you know, we're human. So I get it, you know? And on a certain level, especially if you're not raised with these ideas, and if you didn't learn about this stuff at school, you're gonna be maybe really suspicious of these ideas. I understand that, you know? Instead, I think the best approach...
For knowing what dinosaurs looked like, we now need to know how they lived.
Thank you, Bubsy.
Is it true that stegosaurs evolved armored throat patches so they can eat Captain Crunch?
Bubsy, I appreciate you. Thank you for the 32 months of support there. Thank you very much. And how would you go about testing that hypothesis, Bubsy? What about Captain Crunch would provoke the evolution of armored throat patches? Anyway, yeah. But yeah, yeah, and yeah, we should be real close to that goal, Nina. I'm excited about it. Yeah. Oh, and look! The fog has cleared up a little bit over Berkeley. That video that we just saw took place in Berkeley, and... Yeah, that would have been in... I think it might be that building right there. The Valley Life Sciences building, if that's what if that is the VLSB. But anyway, live cam from the Berkeley Hills. Anyway, nice. There's a city behind the fog. There's several, Caravan. Berkeley, you've got Emeryville over there, and you've got San Francisco off in the distance. Totally behind the fog right now. Can't see it. But yeah. And, yeah. And Catatoon, we have examples we can watch. We do, Catatoon, yeah. Yeah. But that's the thing. The point that I was going to make was that as a science communicator, I have to remember that nobody's going to care how much I know about something until they can relate to me, you know, and until we have some kind of a rapport, you know? There's that old phrase, it's corny, but I think it's true, that nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. You have to be able to trust someone on some level before you can accept what they're telling you, you know? Especially when it's something that might go against what they think they know. I think about this all the time, and I think Tim White did a pretty good job of it right there. And good on him for that, you know? So yeah, yeah. And 23 says, I just realized I was gifted a sub a while ago. I'm not much of a chatter, but I still appreciate it. Thank you for saying so, 20, and I appreciate you being here. Shout out to all the wonderful lurkers out there who... I know you might not be particularly talkative in chat. I appreciate you being there. Thank you for watching and helping bring our numbers up and all that good stuff. So, thank you. Including you, Twerty. Thank you. And Alex Vixen says, happy holidays. And same to you, Alex Vixen. You excited for New Year's? Here's lurking at you, kid. Yeah, there you go, Sculpin. Tony is my baby says, hi, Danny. Thank you for addressing me specifically. Tony is my baby. You're welcome for addressing you specifically. Welcome back. Yeah. And Dinosaur Dave makes a good point here. How did I miss this, Dinosaur Dave? Welcome back to you. Hope your trip is going well. Dinosaur Dave says, the thing is, every conspiracy-natured person I know can't admit they're wrong or that their parents were wrong. To me, being wrong is awesome. Yeah, because you get to learn something new. That's something I've been trying to teach my dad. He's not a conspiracy nut, but he struggles to admit when he's wrong, so I do my best to reinforce the behavior when he does. And that can be an uphill battle, Dinosaur Dave. Yeah. Yeah, especially with... when folks get older, they kind of get stuck in their ways, and... it's... usually detrimental to people. You know? But yeah. And, Quiz Seal says, you always get me... you always got interesting stuff going on here, so lurking is worthwhile. Happy holidays. I appreciate you, Quiz Seal. Happy holidays to you, too. Thank you for the kind words. That's high praise. Thank you. Yeah. I say stupid things at times so I can learn. Sorry for all gaps in school. I imagine you shouting that. That made it... so much better. I imagine somebody in like an adult learning class just like shouting this from the back of the classroom. Don't mind me, I say stupid things at times so I can learn. It's charming, Skullman. It's good. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. And Catatoon says, my mom is 81 now, late motherhood, and she is still keen to learn new things and love to talk when I tell her about new discoveries. That's awesome, Catatoon. That is rare, too. Very cool to hear. I'm happy for you and your mom. That's awesome. Anyway, good stuff. Good stuff. And, yeah. With that having been said, I think we might do kind of a... well, shoot. Now might be a good time to go right into Science Streams. I wanted to start today's stream a little bit later and raid in a little bit earlier because we're doing a crossover. I'm going to be showing up on Balint's stream and we're going to be talking about some new scientific papers this week. And I felt kind of burnt out the last couple weeks that we've done this. I was kind of tired by the end of it and didn't really have, you know, I didn't feel like I could really give it my all. So I think we're going to go do that. So please join me now as we go right into Science Streams and talk about some new scientific papers. I've picked two paleontology papers. Balint has two genetics papers. And we're going to talk about them. Thank you, Salamander UK, for the follow. I appreciate that. Balint of Science Streams is a... oh, we got the ad break going now. Shoot, hang on a minute. And maybe we check the Partner Plus push? Yeah, let me check that real quick. As we wait for the ad to end. Alright. We're at 361 out of 350. We're at 361 out of 350 right now. Holy cow. Yeah. Holy moly. Thank you. Holy cow, everybody. Holy cow. We've met our Partner Plus push goal for the month of December. Just 1 month left now. We do January, and then we've got it. We've got it. Ah, so happy about that. One more month, says Lenina, and she's right, as usual. Yes! Yeah, Steely Dan, that's a great emote there. What is that? Is that Hulk Hogan or something? That's excellent. Very excited. We're going to have Partner Plus. That's a 70-30 revenue split, thanks to you and this community. Everybody, thank you so much for that. Holy cow. Everybody who's helped us out. Extraordinary. 1 month to go, and then we've got it. Ah! Excellent. Well, what a wonderful note. I was going to say to end on, but we're not ending it there. Just jumping into Science Streams. You'll see me on there, so please join us in this raid. Here we go. Raid. Science Streams. There we go. Good stuff. Again, don't go away or you'll be missing several hours of science discussion here. We've got a brand new pterosaur to talk about. And new evidence of a totally, well, not a new dinosaur group, but a new dinosaur group for Denmark. And only the second dinosaur fossils ever published on from Denmark. Along with two genetics papers that Blint has chosen. It's going to be fun stuff. So, don't go away. Thank you to everybody whose names are appearing on the screen in our credits. Thank you to all of those subscribers and gifters, the cheerers and the moderators, and the new followers. Also, the chatters and lurkers and question askers and everybody else. It was a short one today, but it's not over. We're going to do some science discussion. Blint is a molecular and systems biologist. I'm a paleontologist. We're going to be exploring our different fields and kind of seeing where our fields have confluence here. It's going to be a lot of fun, like it always is. I'll see you there, everybody. Join us.
Emote as well for Jern.